Good morning and Merry Christmas to each and every one of you. I know this is not how we have planned to celebrate Christmas this morning, being in our homes, but I know that and I trust that God is doing something incredible through us and in this time. And so I hope that as we enter into this special time of worship, that you are surrounded with your family or friends, and maybe you've got your cup of coffee, hot tea, hot cocoa, whatever it is you're doing to stay warm. I just pray that our hearts and our minds are open to the message that God has for us this morning. So would you join with me in praying our opening prayer? Loving Father, this morning we celebrate the greatest gift, the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we share in the song of the angels, the gladness of the shepherds, and the worship of the wise men. Open the door of love all over the world. Let kindness come with every gift and every greeting. May the light of your love shine brightly to remind us of the wondrous ways you love us. Open our hearts and spirits as we hear the words of your holy scriptures. Give us such joy that it will seem as though our feet aren't even touching the ground. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. You know, one aspect of Advent that I really enjoy is when we light the Advent calendars and recite the liturgy. And sadly, as we were not able to get together on Friday night to light the most important candle, the Christ candle, we are adapting to our current situation and environment. And so I invite you now that if you have a candle available, that as I recite the liturgy, that you would light yours. I'm using this candle as a representative of the Christ candle that we would have in church. Throughout this season, we have lived, waited, and remembered the peace, hope, love, and joy of God found in Christ. I light this candle now as a reminder and as a representative of the Christ candle and the light of Christ that we have. With the birth of Christ, salvation has drawn near. The God who ordered the chaos of the universe has come down into the chaos of our world. The Word, which was with God at the beginning, came down and lived with us. And while we were yet living in the valley of the shadow of death, it is the light of Christ, the light of new life that has burst forth. This morning, remember that God has come in the Christ child. Amen. Next, we will have our first song of praise, and I hope you will sing along with Bing Crosby in Do You Hear What I Hear?
Do you hear what I hear? Said the night wind to the little lamb. Do you see what I see?
Do you see what I see?
Way up in the sky, little lamb. Do you see what I see?
Do you see what I see?
A star, dancing in the night, with a tail as big as a kite, with a tail as big as a kite. Said the little lamb to the shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear? Ringing through the sky, shepherd boy. Do you hear what I hear?
Do you hear what I hear?
A song, high above the tree, with a voice as big as the sea, with a voice as big as the sea. Said the shepherd boy to the mighty king, do you know what I know? In your palace warm, mighty king, do you know what I know? A child shivers in the cold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Said the king to the people every
everywhere. Listen to what I say. Pray for peace, people everywhere. Listen to what I say. The child sleeping in the night, he will bring us goodness and light. He will bring us goodness and light.
Last week in our worship service, I was to have read the In Honor or In Memory list, and unfortunately I was so focused on all the other things, I failed to do that, and I do apologize. So now at this time I would like to do that and read the In Honor and Memory list. And as I read it, you will see the names on your screen appear. In memory of our parents, Ruth and Richard Williams. Daniel Urey Sr., Eddie Johnson, Joe Fay and Charles Schauber, J.B., Anna and John Jones, A.L., Sarah and John Madry, Frankie Forbes, Leonard Bagley, Talman and Geneva Sawyer, Dorothea and Steve Bateman, Joseph and Mary W. Harris, J.J. and Joe Harris, Bagley and Mildred Schauber, William and Mary Courtney Schauber, David and Betty Schauber, Frank and Bertie Williams, Willie C. Temple, Lockwood and Evelyn Schauber, Bailey and Ann Temple, and Ron Hollis. Donna Lockerbie, our parents Richard and Ruth Williams, and William and Martha Bogue, Janet Burke, Everett and Kathleen Brothers, Condor and Amy Granger, Erskine and Helen Brothers, Dorothy Brothers, Janet Stallings, Marvin and Betty White, Lanier and Alma Jones, Mary Bundy, Raleigh Carver, our deceased parents by Paul and Earlene Stallings, Roger Crane, Larry Johnson, Marvin Fisher, Herbert Taylor Mullen Jr., Nancy Ora Stevens, John Kitchen, Hulda and Ernest Stallings, Maud and Richard Kitchen, Leanne and Pam, Alinda and Henry Harris, Marie and Clarence Raper, Joyce Stallings, Mullen and Mabel Stallings, Sylvia Stallings, Louise Godfrey, E.A. and Carolyn Spence, Wally and Margaret Akins, Mary Courtney Schauber, William Schauber, and our parents by Richard and Bonnie Hoffman. In honor of our children and grandchildren by Sarah and Ricky Williams, Edna Bagley, my New Land Church family, the adult Bible class, Pastor Don and family, our choir, Sheila and Sarah, everyone at New Land United Methodist Church, Frank Custer, Danielle and Lily Butler, Grace Johnson, Danielle, Lance, and Josh. Warren Mercer, all Methodist men, our family by Richard and Bonnie Hoffman, Hewitt Cemetery workers, my three sons, grandchildren, and greats by Joanne Kitchen, Rosalie Stevens or his mom, our children Megan, Jeremy, Ian, and Andrea, our grandchildren Carson, Cole, Quinn, and Jackson, Sarah Williams, our children and grandchildren by Paul and Earlene Stallings, Martha Fisher, my husband J.C., Lottie Forbes. May God bless all of those on the list and those on our hearts. And now to the time of prayers of the people. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, you have sent your Son to us to show us the way. Even when we have turned our backs and followed our own paths, you continue to offer us light. Thank you for loving us so much that you would give us this most precious gift. And when we again falter and fail, lift us once again with your gentle touch. Pour your light into our lives once more, that finally we will fully understand the power and depth of your love for us. Lord, we often think of Christmas Day as the final destination for the journey on which we have embarked these past weeks. Advent was a time of preparation, a time to examine our lives, our hopes, our fears. It was a time to place our trust in your never-failing love and to move again towards you, through the darkness, to your light. We again want to hear the powerful reminder of your love, which was intended for us throughout all of time. In the beginning of all creation, your light was given to illuminate the majesty of this place. Your light shined forth through the lives of the prophets, and most especially through your Son, Jesus. Your light has been given. It cannot be hidden. It pours out of those whom it has touched. Healing and comforting God, within all of our hearts now, we lift up the names of those people and situations which need your loving touch. Our hearts ache for those who are ill and for those who mourn. We trust in your comforting love to be with them. For those who feel lost and alone, we ask that you help us reach out to them with your good news of great and abiding love. For all the situations in our world where there is warfare, oppression, strife, and all the dreadful ways in which your people suffer, Holy God, please lay your hand of healing love on them. Help them to feel your powerful presence with them, guiding and strengthening them. These things which we have spoken with our lips and our hearts, we offer in the confidence of your eternal love and in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And now we will have our next musical selection, and it is God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen by Pentatonix.
Merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Dun dun dun. Merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy.
Our scripture reading today comes from John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was with God in the beginning. Everything came into being through the Word. and without the Word, nothing came into being. What came into being through the Word was life, and the life was the light for all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness doesn't extinguish the light. A man named John was sent from God. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, so that through him everyone would believe in the light. He himself wasn't the light, but his mission was to testify concerning the light. The true light that shines on all people was coming into the world. The light was in the world, and the world came into being through the light. But the world didn't recognize the light. The light came to his own people, and his own people didn't welcome him. But those who did welcome him, those who believed in his name, he authorized to become God's children, born not from blood, nor from human desire or passion, but born from God. The Word became flesh and made his home among us. We have seen his glory, glory like that of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified about him, crying out, "This is the one of whom I said, 'He who comes after me is greater than me, because he existed before me.' From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. As the law was given through Moses, so grace and truth came into being through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. God, the only Son, who is at the Father's side, has made God known. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God." Today is all about Jesus. Today is Jesus' day, the day we celebrate the day he was born. First and foremost, this is the day when the distance between heaven and earth was removed, and God set up camp among us. God moved into the neighborhood, or as the literal translation goes, he tented among us, which is what the Gospel of John says. John 1:14 says, "lived among us literally." And literally, he pitched a tent. But today is about the closeness of the living presence of God in the incarnate one we call Jesus. You know, in 1675, long 300 years difference, in 1675, a fire devastated London, England. 9 years after that, Sir Christopher Wren laid a foundation stone in what would be his greatest architectural achievement, the building of St. Paul's Cathedral. Now, if you've ever been to London and you've seen St. Paul's Cathedral in person, you know that the pictures you see on TV or regular pictures, or if you're watching Mary Poppins, St. Paul's Cathedral is there, and it does not do it justice. It is beautiful, truly a beautiful masterpiece. It took Sir Wren 35 years to complete this great achievement. And when it was done, it said that he waited breathlessly for a reaction from Queen Anne. So after Queen Anne was shown through the structure, she summed up her feelings for the architecture in these words: "It is awful. It is amusing. It is artificial." How would you feel if those words were used to describe your greatest achievement, the thing that you worked so hard on? But upon hearing these words from Queen Anne, he heaved a sigh of relief and bowed gratefully before his queen. Now you would think, how can you do this? I mean, but now it's a queen, so one would think you just take what is given. But there's another explanation. In 1710, when this building was done and when Queen Anne saw it, the word "awful" meant awe-inspiring, full of awe-inspiring. The word "amusing" meant amazing, and the word "artificial" meant artistic. So what to our ears sounds like a devastating criticism were in that time words of high praise. And there's a lesson here. There's tremendous power in language and in words. And often the words we use to describe the world around us is contingent upon our understanding and upon the society in which we live. Who knows what awful or amazing or artistic or whatever artificial might mean 300 years from now. But words are important. The meaning of words are important. And it's very true in our scripture passage today. In the first 18 verses of John's gospel, it's referred to as the prologue, where God communicates to us the nature of his coming. It's in these words that contain the most incredible message and truth about God choosing to humble himself, take on humanness in order to save all humans. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. It's been said that these first 18 verses of John contains the simplest and yet the most complex explanation of the nature of Jesus Christ. In my opinion, this is one of the most beautiful passages in the Bible. Now, I love many passages, but this is truly beautiful. The description it offers of Christ is incredibly profound. It is mysterious, mystery, yet comprehensible. It is simple, yet it is filled with so much meaning. Now, former President Jimmy Carter wrote this about the prologue of John's Gospel. He said, the verses quoted begin by saying that the Word, meaning both Greek logos, standing for the truth or wisdom, and the Word of God, as given to the Jews through Moses, became flesh. The Word became flesh. What more common yet descriptive word could we choose? Flesh, the very living stuff of which our bodies are made, our skin, the very substance of what it makes to have a pounding heart, a working brain, the hands that move all the time while I'm preaching. Flesh, and yet this vast mystery of God who came as human is captured in this phrase. Very little words with so much meaning. The Word became a fleshly person like one of us, walking the dusty roads of Palestine, sleeping in the open with a stone or rolled up cloak for a pillow, eating, drinking, laughing with friends. The Word became flesh. Now, I added a little bit of what Jimmy Carter said there, but I think he had a good grasp on what the Gospel of John was trying to tell us. We know that when John uses the word, literally the word word with a capital W, word there with a capital W is Jesus. Jesus is the Word. By the Word becoming flesh, Jesus becoming flesh, God becoming flesh, God spoke to us in a language that we could understand, a language that shouldn't be confused over time, such as Queen Anne's response of awful, amusing, and artificial. By the Word becoming flesh, there is so much significance in God's actions. You know, God walked among us. Or as the NRSV translation states, God lived among us. The CEB translation that's my favorite, that is the one I used, is the Word became flesh and made his home among us. He made his home. He lived among us. God put on the very substance and essence that you and I have. Everything that you and I have, all of it, he took on. It's confusing. It's amazing. It's wonderful and mysterious all at the same time. Have you ever really tried to imagine what it was like when Jesus was born? Have you ever tried to put yourself in that manger scene, be there with Mary, like a fly on a wall with Mary and Joseph and the little baby when Jesus was born? when God put on flesh, really try to be there. Not in the way that's pictured in our beautiful Christmas carols, our manger scenes. One I have right behind me. I have a few more placed around my office as well. They're beautiful. They portray a wonderful image. But not in that sense. Have you ever wondered what the reality of that night was? Or even, have you ever wondered what really caused the shepherds to go seek that baby in the stable? Okay, yeah, an angel appeared to them. Okay, you know. But the thing is, they did something that was totally out of character, something they would not have done. Of course, an angel coming to them is normally not done, but yet they left their flocks behind to go see a little baby. That is highly unusual for shepherds to leave their flocks unattended. So what about this message concerning a king in diapers caused them to be impressed? And deeply impressed they must have been to go looking for a babe, a little babe, in really what is a feeding box. It's what the animals ate out of, right? But have you ever wondered, have you ever thought Jesus wore diapers? No, we don't. Now, we can ask the same question of ourselves. What draws us to come to church every Sunday? What causes us to leave family time or interrupt our busy lives or, you know, put on hold some activity we want to do on a Sunday and to come and worship? Is it because it's tradition? Is it something because you always done? Is it to mark a box off your to-do list? But especially at Christmas time, when we leave our homes and we go to church, traditionally we go to church on Christmas Eve or Christmas Eve Eve, and when church falls on a Sunday, we go to church on Sunday. You know, in my opinion, what draws us to church on Christmas Eve, or for you to take time on Christmas Day to watch this message, is bigger. It's more important. There's a greater reason than just tradition. The greater reason for going to church on Christmas today. Christmas Day. Today, Christmas, is a day when even doubters among us turn into believers, believing if only just for this day, God is born among us. And if the Word of God can take on flesh in the form of a babe, anything is possible with God. I think we all understand the incredible joy and magic that happens when a baby is born, right? When they finally get all cleaned up, let's get them cleaned up first, right? And you can hold a newborn baby. There's just a joy. There's something magical about it, whether it's your own child or your grandchild. Or baby, at the baby of someone you know and love. I'm thinking of Lennon and Carolyn Madry right now, who will welcome today their brand new great-grandson. They will get to hold him and love on him. And they will feel the joy and great love. And there's magic in that. And there's sacredness in those moments when we hold a little baby. I wonder what Joseph was thinking when they held that. But what about the shepherds? They didn't know Joseph or Mary. They were told just to go. Their Savior, who's a newborn baby, was there. And there they went, and they found, at some point, I imagine, Jesus might have been crying. He might have been a crying baby in that feeding box. Now, of course, we know there was more than just a baby in a smelly old barn laying in some hay. The baby in the feeding box stands for something great and wonderful, something so personal, very personal, for us and for those shepherds as well. This little infant, this child who was born of Mary in a barn, a smelly barn, is a mystery of God. The mystery of God stooping down to our humanity. When you think about it, God could have chosen to arrive in royal robes. I mean, he could have come as an adult. He could have had the best, the trumpets. He could have had people surrounding him. You know, at the very least, God could have arranged for Joseph and Mary to have a room in a Bethlehem Inn. But God chose to come to us in an unconventional yet very ordinary way. Now, humanly speaking, there simply is no magic left when we arrive in a stable and see a baby in a feeding box. I mean, think about you going to a barn, seeing a little baby in something that your animals would be eating out of. You would probably be astounded. You would probably cry out in shock and grab that and take the child to safety and get them out. But yet, again, God didn't choose to do something easy, something we always would do, or something that was always done in those times when Jesus was born. There was something extraordinary in the very humanness of a real baby in a manger. We find the mystery of Emmanuel, God with us. God stooped down to the most ordinary human level, and because of it, we know that there is hope. And suddenly, because of this extraordinary yet ordinary event, all things seem possible. And that's why the barn was better than the inn, because God, through Jesus, endured the full scope of what can sometimes be a difficult human experience. He did that so there is hope for everyone. Now, speaking about this mystery, Barbara Brown Taylor, who is a well-known author and professor of homiletics or preaching, she teaches preaching, or she used to, she's retired now. But in one of her books, Decked Out in Flesh, she wrote, "Choosing flesh, God chose the lowest human common denominator, and in doing so, left us no escape from his presence." That is why it is so important to let the star show us a real child, to believe that what Mary and Joseph got was no Hallmark baby, but a belching, squalling infant who kept them up nights for weeks, and that in choosing to make his entrance in such an ordinary way, God showed us that flesh and blood, dirt and sky, life and death were good enough for him. And more than that, he hallowed them. He made them holy by taking part in them and left us nothing on earth we can dismiss as trivial or unknown to him. I think that was it. I love that. There's nothing. God took everything, and because he made everything holy. He took part in humanity, and there's nothing that he doesn't know about what it is to be human. You know, underneath our nicest clothes, underneath whatever image we try to project, underneath all of it hides an ordinary human soul. Our souls which cry out for God's love. We want God's love. So underneath anything we put on is our soul that longs for God's love. That's the way we were made. We were made to want a relationship with God. God wants a relationship with us. And God, through the baby Jesus, who snuggled in a manger, reaches out to our human souls, our ordinary human souls, and says, "Don't be afraid. For behold, I bring good news, good tidings, great joy to you." Barbara Brown Taylor also said, "Keep in mind that a baby is, in the best of worlds, evidence that a love affair has taken place. Then that is certainly the case with this particular child, a love affair. A child is come because of a love affair. And that is the case with Jesus. God has loved humankind from the moment he thought us up. Isn't that beautiful? I found that so moving when I read it for the first time, and I wanted to make sure I shared it with you. God has loved all of us. God has loved humankind. He has loved each one of us from the very moment He thought us up. The very moment He thought us into being, when the Word was with God in creation. That's a true message of Christmas, that God loves us so much that He became like one of us, even like the least among us. And once again, during this Christmas season, the ordinary becomes holy, and the holy ordinary in the Word made flesh. In Him we see ourselves, but in Him we also see a great love which God loves us, even while we are yet sinners. And in Him we see a way out of the darkness, our fears, our sin, and our frail human condition. God, through Jesus, reaches to the very core of our soul, saying, I came to save you. No matter how lowly you may be, or how low you think you are, or you don't even have to reach up. I'm reaching down to you. You don't have to reach up. I'm just take what I've given. Just accept my gift of love and salvation. You know, the tremendous power of language of John 1 speaks of an unimaginable, overwhelming love. Can you imagine? Unimaginable. We can't imagine the depth of love. It's so overwhelming, the love that God has for each one of us, and He chose to come and make His home with us. There's a Christmas card in the inside, you know, Christmas card. I love getting my Christmas cards and reading them. And I thank you for all the Christmas cards I've gotten. And not this year, but there was a Christmas card. And it said, the word did not become a philosophy to be discussed, a theory to be debated, a concept to be pondered. The word became a person to be followed, enjoyed, and loved. Let me read that again. The inside of the Christmas card said, the word Jesus, did not become a philosophy to be discussed. Jesus is not a theory to be debated. He is not a concept to be pondered. Jesus became a person to be followed, enjoyed, and loved, to have a relationship. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Each one of us came into being by Him, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That's a beautiful thing. He became flesh. He dwelt among us. And yet, even though He has been resurrected and He is with the Father, He is still living among us. Let us embrace once again God's great gift of Jesus, in which He proves His love for us once and for all. Let's open the doors of our hearts and let Jesus move right on in, make His home with us, so He will stay with us forever. Merry Christmas and amen. I truly hope that you have a wonderful and blessed Christmas day in whatever tradition, whatever celebrations you choose. And I just pray that you will feel the presence of the Word who became flesh. And He is living among us in our hearts right now. Next, we'll have our final closing song. We would normally sing this in church, but I found a wonderful, beautiful version. Go Tell It on the Mountain. I hope this will inspire you, and may you feel the presence of the Word within the words of this song. you be filled with the wonder of Mary, the obedience of Joseph, the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, the determination of the Magi, and the peace of the Christ child. And may the Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Thank you for participating in this morning's service. I wish you the very merriest of Christmases and an incredible and grace-filled new year in which we can grow in our faith together, where we can serve our Savior by sharing His love with those in our community and beyond, and where we will experience the wondrous and amazing and beautiful presence of the Holy Spirit. God bless you all, and I'll see you next year.